Okay. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to invite all of y'all, go ahead and come in, and I'm going to talk to y'all for just a moment. We're going to, a couple of things different. Number one, I'm kind of hot, John. Can you turn my mic down a hair? Because I hear me real good. I don't know if y'all can. Miss Patty, you'll have all day to look at that. I'll draw your attention to this side of the platform. I put a chart up. This is one of my charts. This is years of study that I started back while I was still at Glad Tidings. And then I went to Vivian, where I really worked on it for 5 years. And then, of course, I'm 7 years up here, and now I'm pastoring here. So I thought I would share that with you, but that's not the important thing. We'll get to that later, but that's one of my charts. As y'all come in, I want to open in prayer. I want to draw your attention to something that I need you to see. This is about an 8 minute and some change video. And I don't know if you, anybody here know Jonathan Kahn? Okay. This is Jonathan Kahn. Let me open this in prayer, and there's two needs that I want to take into the throne room, Joey and Sandy. Let's open in prayer. Father, this morning as we come before you, it's to see your kingdom manifested in our lives. God, I'm so thankful for your mercies that are new every day and the fact that you love us. God, it's such a reckless love, and we thank you for that love. But today, right now, Father, we're asking you as we lift up Joey now into your presence. God, you know the need. I speak against an infection in his body. I command it to loose his body and to be gone. Father, I ask you for favor that this man will rise up and call you blessed. Father, I thank you for the touch upon Joey in Jesus' name. And Father, I lift up Sandy. And God, her heart's to be here with the children. But Lord, her body is struggling. So today, Father, as I lift her into your presence, I command her body. Body, receive your healing. You are healed. Every muscle, every nerve, every cell in the bones, I command them to line up in Jesus' name and to be healed. Now, Father, I thank you for what you're doing, because your word says what you've begun, you're more than able to complete. We're calling forth a completed healing in Joey, a completed healing in Sandy, that they will stand in your presence and shout your praises. Father, we ask your blessing upon our service today. What you're about to do, lead us and teach us that we may return to you in Jesus' name.
This is Jonathan Kahn. We are standing at a pivotal moment in American history and world history, a moment that can permanently seal our nation's course and the course of the world for good, for bad, for calamity, or redemption. America and much of Western civilization was founded on a biblical foundation stone, but it's turned away from that foundation. We have not only driven God out of our public life, and have called what is good evil and what is sin good, but we have sacrificed the lives of over 60 million unborn children. And America's fall from God is not only progressing, it's accelerating to the point that it's no longer just a falling away, but a war against the purposes of God. I wrote in the Harbinger of the signs of judgment that appeared in the last days of ancient Israel, warning of calamity, that these same signs of warning have now appeared on American soil. The biblical template concerning judgment is that the nation so warned is given a space of time to return or to head for judgment and calamity. We are now in that window of time. But if America continues on its present course, that window will come to an end, and there will come a flood that will begin the end of religious freedom, even usher in persecution and seal America's fall. And if America falls, it will affect the entire world. This year, 2020, is crucial as it leads to a presidential election in which the stakes are higher and the necessity of prayer more critical than ever before. And even if the election goes in the direction of biblical values and righteousness, If we don't see a spiritual turning, an awakening, a repentance, revival, then all the political, legal, judicial, and cultural efforts will ultimately fail or be undone. We have a window of time, and the purpose of that window is to return and for revival. Without that return, America will be lost. What can we do? What can you do? In the days following 9/11, people flocked to houses of worship, and it looked as if there could have been a spiritual revival, an awakening. But it never came, because there was no repentance. And without repentance, without a turning back, there can be no revival. But I have seen, once in my life, the hand of God change the course of American and world history. And it all began, not in the halls of government, but with the people of God who gathered in a sacred assembly in our nation's capital with the scripture, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their sinful ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land." It can happen again. But if we don't respond now, at this most critical moment, we may never have the chance to do so again. Since the time of 9/11, I've been calling for return, for repentance, for revival, not only as individuals, but as a nation, according to 2 Chronicles 7:14. At the same time, a faithful man of God, Kevin Jessup, has for years carried the burden of a sacred assembly for that same purpose of restoration. We are convicted that now is the time. Therefore, this is the announcing of the return, the national and global day of prayer and repentance. It will be a day, and more than a day, a time and a season for the movement for prayer, repentance, return, and revival. The central day will be Saturday, September 26th, in a sacred assembly, according to what is laid forth in Scripture, to take place in our nation's capital on the Washington Mall. For those who can't make it or want to do something where you are, then gather together in your states, your cities, in your towns, in your houses of worship, in your homes, or be part of those gatherings already planned. This will take place not only 40 days before the presidential election, but also on the 400th anniversary of the sailing of the Mayflower in the days of America's founding and dedication to God. And surrounding the day of return on September 26th will be 10 days, known from ancient times as the 10 days of repentance, starting with the Feast of Trumpets and ending on the Day of Atonement, to set as a special time to intensify our prayers, our intercessions for repentance and revival, September 18th to September 28th. Believers and leaders who are already part of the return include everybody from Pat Robertson to Dr. James Dobson, from Billy Graham's daughter, Ann Graham Lotz, to Martin Luther King's niece, Alveda King, and many, many more. When does the return begin? Right now. How? With you and me, as we commit this time and this year for return, prayer, repentance, and revival. To commit first to our own repentance and to begin actually living in revival. And then to pray for others, the return and revival of our nation and the world. You who are parents, begin by leading your families in revival. Ministers, lead your groups in revival. Pastors, lead your churches into revival. Leaders of ministries, movements, and denominations, lead your people into revival. And spread the word to everybody you can. Let the believers, pastors, and churches in your areas know. Use social media, use everything you can to spread the word so they can have a part. And if you're watching this and you're not sure you know God, or that your life is in His will, then come to Him now, or come back to Him now, and then come join in the return. So I invite you to come to the nation's capital on the Washington Mall, September 26th, 2020. Plan now. You can rent buses, trains, cars, planes, however you can come, or gather wherever you are. And if you're watching this from a nation outside of America, you can be part of bringing the return to your nation by doing what I've set forth in this message and going to the return website for more information. I'll be sending out more messages as we go forth. But for now, for more information, to have a greater part, to represent the return in your area, or to stay up to date, if you're not already on that site, go to the website for the return, which is easy to remember. It's thereturnwebsite.org. That's thereturnwebsite.org. The Lord is calling. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their sinful ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. The movement and chance we have before us now may never come again. If we don't return now, we may pass the point of no return. So now, in view of the calling and of the moment before us, let us each rise to that call, to do what he has called us to do, to believe for great and mighty things we know not of, to return and seek to live in revival and become messengers of revival. It's time to break up our fallow ground. It's time to seek the Lord as never before. It's time to return.
Morning. So we're going to receive our offerings up this morning. So I was studying a little bit. This actually tied in very, very well. So our prayer, our time of prayer, and our time of getting before God is an offering as well, right? So whenever we're in time of prayer, that's a seed. That's a time seed, right? It's very, very important. Whenever we take care of the things of God, we're busy. Like, I'm a busy guy all the time. And I know there's a lot of other people here that are super busy. But whenever we take care of God's things, he'll take care of ours. Right. Whenever we kind of put it at his feet and let him take care of it, he'll take care of our stuff if we're taking care of his. Amen. So I was studying, and the word, while y'all are getting your offerings ready, I'll share this with you. But in the word offering is mentioned more than 700 times. I didn't count them all, but it's between 725 and 750 times the word offering is mentioned. And one of those times is in Deuteronomy. And I was reading this in Deuteronomy in chapter 14. Down he's telling the people all about tithing and how they should do it. But down in verse 28, it says, "At the end of every 3 years, you shall bring out all of the tithe of your produce in the same year and lay it up within your towns. And the Levite, who is the tribe where the priests came out of, because he has no portion or inheritance with you, and the sojourner and the fatherless and the widow who are within your town shall come and eat and be filled, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands that you do." So this is a picture of the church. This is a picture of the people bringing their offerings into the church, because that's what we do, right? Religion has told us that money is the root of all evil, and that is a lie. The love of money is the root of all evil. Money itself is a tool that churches and ministries use to get the word of God out. So as a people, we bring that into the storehouse, according to Malachi, so that there might be meat in our house, and we can feed the widows, we can feed the fatherless, we can do those things that we're called to do. Amen. Anyway, that was on my heart. I wanted to share it with you this morning. Be encouraged. This is going to be a good time bringing prayer back to our nation. So if y'all want to go ahead and take up the offerings. Steve, it's all you, buddy.
Good week. Mm-hmm. You're not. Did y'all have a good week? week?
Yes.
There you go.
Okay. Yes.
We got to go to sunny Florida. It was really sunny. Because we were outside building a deck. It was a little toasty. But God had some interesting things. You know, he has you where you need to be. You know, he places you in positions and places. And I'll share that with you sometime. We had an interesting event on the way home late at night on the Interstate 10 bridge. And got to minister to a young man who had been rear-ended by somebody who was driving way, way, way too fast. And then he had us there to protect him. So kind of interesting how God does things. You just don't expect. Here we've been all week long thinking we're doing the good deed over here when I got something else for you on the way. You know, so just be instant in season and out of season. Kind of like when a pastor calls you on the way home and says, hey, I got this song. Which we'll do later. Let's stand together. Doing the Macarena to that song. What a blessing.
Come on, yes.
Hallelujah.
There's a grace when my heart is under fire. Another love when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Standing next to me, there was another in the waters, holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminding how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me. There is another in the fire. Come what may in the space between all the things I see and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. To me, I'll count the joy from every night. count the joy of every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Blessed are the ones who do not bury all the broken pieces of their heart. Blessed are the tears of all the weary, pouring like a sky of falling stars. Blessed are the wounded ones in mourning, brave enough to show the Lord their scars. Blessed are the hurts that are not hidden, open to the healing touch of God. Oh,
still have strength to love their enemies. Blessed is the faith of those who persevere. Though they fall, they'll never know defeat. The kingdom is yours. Oh, yeah. The kingdom is yours. Hold on a little more. This is not the end. Hope is in the Lord. Keep your eyes on Him. The kingdom.
Season right now that I am looking for ways to say yes to God. Not that I not normally are, but I'm really in this strong season of asking Him, God, what can I say yes to? What do you need me to do? And I got thinking about it the other day. I was talking to another church member about it. You know, God is omnipresent, omnipotent. He is the most highest thing ever in existence, and He thinks enough of me to ask me for my help. That is mind-blowing, that He doesn't need my help, but he asks me, and He asks us. And how amazing is that, that my Father loves me so much and thinks so much of me, that though He doesn't need it, He wants to ask me. And I want to say yes. I want to be available to say yes. And I've been asking Him, God, how can I be available to You? Show me how to be available. Do I fail every day at being available or saying yes to Him? Yeah, I do. But He still asks me. He still comes back and says, will You be available to me? Will You say yes to me? And I say yes. Yes, I will. So as we sing this next song, I just want y'all to listen to the words. And I want you to find ways to seek Him. Find ways to find Him. Find ways to be more available to Him. And find ways to say yes to Him.
Yeah. missing, church. The more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you. Can you hear me calling to you? Can you hear me calling to you? Can you hear me calling? I want to walk with you.
By the Lord this morning. He's calling you. He's calling you. You that need prayer, step out and come get in front. You got a need. You need to be prayed for. I need you to step out and come get in front here. Come on down, all of you. This is God's moment for you. He's calling you. You hear him. This is not a place to stand and wonder. Come and stand in the presence of God as they sing this song. I need you to just line up across here. Line up across here. We're going to change everything. We're going to move where God wants us. I want to be where God's at. Don't you want to be where God's at? All right, now all of you that are down front and all of you that are back there, stretch your hands towards him. You, as they play this song, think about what he's saying. God's speaking to you through this song. He wants your presence. He's asking for you to be here. Sing, my brother.
Can you hear me calling? Can you hear me calling? Can you hear me calling to you? Yes, won't you let me in? Won't you let me in? Won't you let me in? Can you hear me knocking? I wanna walk with you. I wanna talk with you.
The more I find you,
I'm a wreck with your love, overwhelm us with your love. We're ready and waiting for you. We're ready and waiting for you. We're ready and waiting for you. Church, if you receive, sing, we receive. Oh, we receive. Ready for you, Jesus. Yes. Ready for you. Jesus. Sing, we receive, we receive.
Praise God. Brothers and sisters, is there anyone else here that needs prayer before we move to the next portion of our service? Anybody? 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 Okay. Y'all may be seated. Was that your last song? Well, then, did you weren't offended that I broke in, right? Thank y'all for being so faithful. Let's give God praise. Let's give God good praise. He alone is worthy of praise. Hallelujah to his name. Hallelujah. They're going to bring my board in this morning. I'm going to go back and mention to you guys that I was doing sign language. She understood what I needed. This side out. We'll freak them out if you flip it over too early. I promise you. Okay, I brought my phone up here, something I never do, but there's something here I want to read to you off the phone that I found this morning, so I'm going to have to ask y'all to bear with me. Wow. I'm trying to behave, but I want to run around in here in circles, y'all. Y'all just don't understand. I've been seeing this in the spirit. And I've been trying to prepare you for what was about to happen. We are going to see the return. We are going to simulcast that here. I've already signed us up for it. And I've already done one simulcast with John and I here a couple of days ago. Y'all forgive me, but my teeth are dry. I think I need to stop. Let's go plan B. Little one. John, cut my mic. I don't know what you call that dance. Okay. In ministry that we used to do years ago, that was a worship song that we would break out. I'd have 6-8 churches. I'd have 300-400 people there. And when they started stuff like that, they'd come out of the aisles and come down front and just dance before the Lord. I would challenge some of y'all sometime to let off some of this old worldly junk and come dance before the Lord. As David danced. You took it right out of... Listen to what she said. Come on. Can I get in the presence of a living God? Oh, yes. Will I go there? I choose to be in His presence. You forgive me if I get a little excited, but I know what He done for me. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Woo! What time is it? Oh, I got a lot of time. Praise God. And you just stay warmed up. Me and you fixing to go. Come on. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Son of the living God. My King, my Lord, my Savior. My soon coming Prince. Hallelujah. Y'all do know He's coming, right? Oh, call him my hata. Listen, I got to calm myself down. Ooh, ooh, ooh. I can smell His presence, y'all. You don't think so? Come up here and walk with me a minute. I'm telling you, He's here, y'all. Oh, God. My pastor over here, my brother, my friend, my anchor, Brother James pointed out something to me a while ago, and you know, it's something I knew, but I didn't see the pattern. I'm going to talk to y'all about that a little bit. Look right here. On my chart, here's Jesus. There's Jesus. Y'all can tell I'm a little fired up. I can't hold it still. That ain't going to happen now. 1,000, 2,000. This is where we are right now today. 2,020 years A.D. after His death. Brother James said, you know, that ain't but 2 days in God's eyes. Yeah, my sister Joy. Wow is right. What is that to God? It means nothing. He walks in and out of the presence. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. His spirit moves. Time ain't nothing to Him. Now, I'm telling y'all, we got a storm coming, and that's what I want to preach on today. I'm going to take you on a journey. I thought the message was going to be heavy, but I can see right now it ain't going to be heavy at all. I mean, I thought it was going to be heavy, but dude, knowing He's coming, I can't worry about tomorrow. I can't even worry about getting home today. I want His presence. And I'm telling y'all, this is a rehearsal for the real thing. Now, dog, y'all ought to get, I mean, doggone it, y'all ought to get this. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 4, verse 13. And I titled this message, The Lord, This Coming Storm. Because, see, if y'all will look around us, look at the conditions and the things that's going on, it ought to be a sign. Somebody here ought to be seeing this besides me. 1 Thessalonians, chapter, this is going to be a challenge. I'm up to it. You watch what I do. Come fish this thing out from behind my mic so I don't pull my mic off. Bring it all the way around. I'd like to read what I'm going to say to you. Thank you so much. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others have no hope. Verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which also sleep in Jesus will God bring with Him. Verse 15. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that which we are that we, which are alive, I got my glasses on, and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Now, I've just said three verses. I'm going to unpack it in Louis language. Louis language, Louis. Louis, Louis, oh, we got to go now. Okay, we're going. You see, there was some teaching out there that said that when people died, it was over. That it was done. Oh, it ain't the way it is with God. This old body may lay down, but the spirit and the soul live forever. We came from God, we're going back to God. One way or the other. I don't make the rules. And so he's coming against some terrible teaching. Let me unpack that. Y'all do know we have some terrible teaching going on right now. Y'all, we have a coming storm. Verse 16 says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the shout." Listen. "And with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." Well, let's unpack that for a minute. God himself is coming. He ain't sending somebody else. He coming himself. Now, let's stop and think about that for a minute. You know and I know that Scripture says that when he finished his work, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. Well, if he sat down, he ain't doing nothing. You can't do much sitting down except pray, order things to be done. But the position of sitting down says his work complete. So how's this work being done? You and me. You and me. He is expecting you and I to be doing something. What is he expecting us to do? The will of the Father. This is not hard. This is very simple, 101, common, plain, simple. But here he is. He descends from heaven with a shout. Oh, can I tell you? He's going to shout so loud that the dead in the ground. Now you think about what I'm fixing to tell you. The dead in the ground themselves will come together. Reformed bodies. Now let's think about that for a minute. I've had the misfortune to go to some house fires where there was nothing left but ashes. We knew it was a body. We could identify that it was a body, but it was pretty much nothing left but ashes. In World War II, and I've been watching some of that stuff this past week. It's just, anyway. Those sailors, when they died, they slid them over the side of the ship. Right, Kenny? Over the side of the ship. Hey, Don, I'm sure you're watching. You was in the Navy, Air Force, I think, in the Navy, but with the Air Force. In World War II, Korea, Vietnam, I think, he told me. Listen, what happened to all those bodies? They've been long gone. But that shout will bring them all back together. He is going to order something. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 1. And God said, there's the shout. It's the same thing. There's the shout. And with the voice of the archangel, let me just think on that a minute. Your idea of an archangel and mine are probably not exactly the same. I've been to a mountain. Well, I've been to the prayer chapel in Colorado Springs, and I wished I had that picture. But you walk into the prayer chapel, and right in the front of it is this image of an angel. And he's got that look on his face, and he's drawing his sword. And I'm telling you, when you walk in the door, it will stop you dead in your tracks. Yeah, it's a wow. I promise you it's a wow. Let's just, can I play with y'all's mind a minute? Because I do this. I play with myself. I run off and do goofy. When Jesus was on the cross and he was dying, I visioned that all of heaven had their swords drawn and was hanging on the edge of heaven, waiting for him to say, come. Yes. This earth would have been wiped out in seconds. Uh-huh. Because if one angel can kill 185,000 men in an hour, or a night, day, whatever it was, heaven could really do a terrible job in seconds. And yet, his love for us, he held him up there and would let him come get him. You want to know how much God loves you? There's no way I can account to you how much God loves you. The voice of the archangel, the one that God tells, do this and it gets done. And with the trump of God, y'all know what the trump of God is, right? That's the trumpet. Now, today would be a cool day to get to teach you that, but it's not on the menu. But let me put it to you like this. The priests too, took two as a witness, go up on the top of the temple, and they would look to the east, and the moment both of them saw the moon, not one of them, both of them had to see the moon, they blew silver trumpets. Just think on that for a while. The trump of God will sound. The dead in Christ will rise first, and you and I that are alive and remain shall be changed. This old body is going to end. It ain't going to be the same. We're going to look like Jesus. Now, I don't know what he looks like. I got all kind of wild ideas. Because when you can walk through walls and do this and do that, it's got to be pretty cool. God chose you for that. He wants you to do that. But you know, and I know, to do that, we got to do the will of the Father. And I got to tell you, the times are coming when it's fixing to be rough here. And we're going to have an opportunity to see a great harvest. So our mind, don't worry about, oh my God, we're not going to have toilet paper. Who cares? I'm not going to get graphic with that. But that ain't the big deal. Oh my Lord, we're not. Can I imagine, can you just take a moment? Let me play with your mind. I can do this. I got time. They're predicting an earthquake at the Madrid Fault. Y'all know that's Mississippi, Arkansas. They have recorded an earthquake in, I think it was 1811. I think that was the year. It shook. It was above a 9. It made the Mississippi River run backwards for 3 days. That's recorded history. It shook so hard that the bells in the churches in Boston, Massachusetts shook, rang them. They're predicting another one of those here. This morning, magnitude 5.1, Sparta, North Carolina. It shook in Virginia. It shook in Knoxville, Tennessee. Felt it this morning. As of right now, today, I think there's been like 46 earthquakes just today. That's a 2.5 or above. That's my phone. That's history. The Lord himself is going to descend. He's coming for you. His love for you, his concern for you is so much, he's going to personally come and get you. Now, you think on that. You girls that's ever waited on a boy to show up at the house and to take you on a date? You boys that rush to that house, itchy, itchy, scratchy, scratchy, to have that date, to ta-ta them? Y'all don't remember that? Some of y'all ain't telling the truth. Verse 17. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we be ever with the Lord. Last verse, chapter 4. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Be of good cheer. He's coming to get us. I don't care how bad it gets, and it rains on the just and the unjust. There's some good people going to get hurt. But he's coming. 2 days. 2 days. What's that to God? You and I need to be ready. Watch this. Chapter 5. Verse 1 says, but the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. What? Let me read it again. It's in my Bible. But of the times and of the seasons, brethren, you have no need I write unto you. What's he saying? You and I are supposed to know the times and the seasons. He's coming. For you, verse 2, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. You know what it said? What's that mean? We're not going to know when he's coming. And when he comes, it'll be a shock. For you, has ever had your house broke into? You come home and they've been in your house? Boy, that's gut-wrenching. I can tell you, as a police officer going into people's houses, I was asleep. He had to have walked over here to my bed with me laying in it and took my wallet and left. How could he come in my... That's the way the Lord's coming. You think you're ready. He's going to come and it's going to be a shock. As a thief is in the night. That's the picture he's giving us. Verse 3. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction come upon them as travail upon a woman with child. They shall not escape. What is he saying? I'm glad you asked. You see, you get comfy in your pew and you get lazy in your ministry. He'll be here and you won't even know he came. Ooh. Don't you think on that for a minute. What's he saying to you and I? He's saying to us to be wise and watchful. Watch and pray. We're praying every Sunday afternoon, my commercial, right here, from 5 to 6. You're welcome to come. I want to return. I want to return to my first love. That's Jesus. I want to return to coming and knowing how to pray and fervently praying. Because I'm going to tell you something. 1 hour of praying is fervent. If you don't believe so, you come down here for an hour. You can pray everything you know in about 5 minutes. Some of you might stretch it to 10. Okay? So this thing is about coming to a place of lining ourselves up with the Word of the living God, because it's His Word that we need to learn how to pray. Part of it is learning how to pray it. Verse 4. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day should overtake you. There's a day coming, and we're not supposed to let that day slip up on us. I can tell you, I almost could tell you the day. I can't tell you the hour, and I can't tell you the year. But I can tell you when he's coming. It's a feast. If he completed the first four feasts on the day and hour, what's the odds that he'll complete the next three on the day and hour? How hard is this? The next feast is the Feast of Trumpets. Oh, I read that. Verse 16 said, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God." That's a feast. Now, I don't know what year it is, and I can't tell you what hour, but I can guarantee you when he comes, it'll be on the Feast of Trumpets. I'm that smart. So I'm supposed to be doing something, preparing myself for when that day is. And what's that to God? Y'all, there's so many patterns in the Word of God that we miss because we're not paying attention to what's being said. We read it, and it's like water running off a duck. We don't let it get down inside and really gnaw and chew and study this Word, meditate on this Word, practice this Word in a way that glorifies Him. Listen. Verse 5. 5:5 says, "But ye are children of the light." Are you not children of the light? Is not Jesus in you? Then your light must be shining. Light on the hill? Bushel? Light? Bushel? Bite? Our light's supposed to be shining. What does that mean? to me and you, it means a lot that people need to be able to look at you and say, you know, you must serve God. I had a guy, this, I don't know if I told y'all, I was at the shop. This guy was using the F word every other sentence. I walked into the shop and he just cussing up a storm. I walked over there, about the third time he used it, I said, well, praise God. And he heard it, but it didn't click. And he saying something else, and he said it again. I said, thank you, Jesus. Glory be unto your name. And he shut up. And he looked around at me like, whoa. And I went on, because on that point, I'm going to just give God all the praise I can. My light's going to shine, y'all. You hear me? My light's going to shine. I started talking about how good God was and how good a week this has been. And God, I thank you for... And he stopped, leaned over on the lift, put his hand in his pocket, looked at me and said, you must be a preacher. Maybe. I'm a child of God. Can you see my light? He goes, man, if I offended you, I said, you know, you're not offending me. But I see no point in putting up with that. Because every time you cuss, I'm going to praise God. He said, well, you know, I got something I need to do. And he slipped on out and he left. And I've also had them that said, well, I'll just cuss nastier. Well, that's okay. I'll just pray louder. Verse 5, you are children of the light and children of the day. We are not of the night and of darkness. I don't want darkness in me. Darkness represents evil spirit. I don't want darkness in me. I don't allow it. I want to see the glory of a living God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, listen to verse 6. Therefore, y'all remember what I said about them therefores? Let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. I need you to stretch yourself. Move out of your comfort zone and come and pray for an hour. Tuesday, 6 o'clock, we fast from 6 to Wednesday, 6. Excuse me. We are preparing ourselves. And how hard is this? I mean, for some of y'all, that's a stretch. That shouldn't be a stretch at all. Y'all be able to do that laying down. Because I'm fixing to move you to 3 days of fasting. Y'all need to get ready. And for some of you say, well, I can't do that. You know what? Maybe it's not food. Maybe you need to put this thing up for 3 days. Just turn that sucker off, let it charge. And for 3 days, live without it. That thing is such an addictive force in all our lives. I find myself in the morning reading the news because I'm picky about what I read because I don't trust none of them. I don't even trust Fox. I'm trying to read between the lines. As a police officer, I would go to a crime scene, and the next day when I read it, it wasn't even nothing like what took place. The person was there and wrote what he wanted to write. It was sensational to sell a paper, and that's all he wanted. He didn't want the truth. Now, he didn't lie, but he just didn't give you all the facts. Here, God is giving you all the facts. Listen now. Verse 7. For they that sleep in the night, and they that be drunken, are drunken in the night. What does that mean? Well, let's put it in a... Let me look at that for a minute. For they that sleep, that's they that willingly choose not to do what I need to be doing. I'm just going to sleep through this. At night, that's darkness. And those who drunk are drunk at night. So you make choices to do what you want in darkness. And that darkness could be in the daytime. Listen, it says in John, don't let the light be in darkness. That's what he said in John. I'd have to go look it up. I can't remember. Chapter 11 maybe, but I should know it. And I will get it right for you. But that's an interesting word. When he said, don't let your light be in darkness, that light is worship. Don't let your worship be stolen by an enemy. That's what he said. But you and I would have to study that to understand what was taking place. What was he saying? He's telling us something about a coming storm. And if I can get into Matthew today, I will get you there in chapter 24. May not make it. You may have to get the rest of this story next week. I got a little time. Verse 9. Verse 8. But let us, who are of the day, be sober. Pay attention. Listen to what's going on. Watch and pray. Putting on the breastplate of faith. Oh, dude. You know what's the opposite of faith? Fear. Fear steals, faith believes. God didn't give you a spirit of fear. There is a spirit of fear. But he gave you of love, joy, and a sound mind. Be vigilant. Be understanding. Be careful. Watch what you say that you don't give the enemy a place to attack you. Watch your words. If you want to be healed, you walk healed. I'm healed. I don't care what the world says, I'm healed. And if my old body quits, I'm still healed. I'm going to walk in healing. I'm not going to give place to this devil or any devil if I can help it. Not intentionally. And when I do make a mistake, I'm quick. When God convicts me about it, I run and ask God, please forgive me. Because I wasn't careful with my words. I wasn't careful with my actions. I wasn't careful in what I did. Wow. Where was I at? Verse 8. Put on the breastplate of faith and love. Y'all, without love, we will never see God. Never. And how do you love God? Love one another. You do this to the least of these, you've done it unto me. Think about it. And the hope of salvation, that's faith. I know he's coming for me. Do I deserve it? Absolutely not. But I'm so grateful it does. I want what he wants. I want to see what he wants to see. I want to do what he wants to do. He's telling me to do it. I'm going to go do it. Verse 10. Who died for us that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Either we're alive or we're dead. It makes no difference. The moment this body quits, we're with him. Verse 11 says, therefore, comfort yourselves together and edify, strengthen, even as you do. I want to note something to you now. I want you to listen to me. Listen very carefully. These are some powerful words that I wrote. Seducers are far more dangerous to the church than persecutors. Seducers are far more dangerous than persecutors. We have to be careful not to be seduced to believe the lie. Let me give you one. Well, you're saved, you can go do what you want. That's a lie. That's right out of the pit of hell. Here's another one. You're not saved if you don't speak in tongues. That's a lie. Has nothing to do with salvation. Don't let somebody seduce you with the twisted truth of the living God. You go back. It's your responsibility. You go back and you open that word and you read it for yourself and you meditate on it and God will let you know what you're supposed to do. You don't have to question it, but you got to be careful where you hear it. I'm real picky about the people that I listen to. I don't just listen to everybody. I've had people bring me books. They're on the shelf. I never read them. I don't want to hurt nobody's feelings. But if I don't know this author and I don't have time to study and see where their rooted ground it is, who they came, I ain't going to take time with it. I got something in the kingdom I need to be doing. And the word itself is my bond. I want to take you on a journey now in Matthew chapter 24. Some of y'all are not going to like this. I can just go on and tell you. Matthew chapter 24, verse 1. I got about 20 minutes. And I think the first two verses will take that 20 minutes. Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And verse 2 says, and Jesus said to them, do you see these, all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left upon the other. It shall all be torn down. Now, in the New King James, therefore comfort one. Oh, that's the Thessalonians. Matthew chapter 24, verse 1, if you have that. But listen, guys, for a moment. Let me point something out. Jesus departed the temple. He departed the temple. Y'all realize he never went back? Oh, it gets deeper. He departed that temple. He was done with it. that ceremonial law, he was done with it. That Levitical priesthood, he was done with it. The one he established, he was done with it. Y'all remember the story of Saul and how Samuel wept over Saul because Samuel, being the intercessor and the prophet and the priest of God, the man of God, wept over the sin of this man? What did God tell him? He said, stop praying for him. I'm done with him. Ooh, geez, y'all, that's a pretty scary place to be. You hear me? That God would try to reach you and try to shake you up and to try to wake you, and you just headstrong and stubborn, and at a point he says, I'm done with you. Ow, that hurts. And this was the king. This was the man chosen by God. Need to carefully listen to what's being said. You see, he departed. His public work was over. And what's really interesting, he said to the Pharisees, I left your house desolate. He did. In the previous chapter, he said, I left your house desolate. We're talking about the temple and all the gold and all the stuff therein. He departed from it. We need to be careful that he doesn't depart from us. Because of our hard-heartedness and our stubbornness and our unwillingness to listen to a living God. It could happen. I don't think it's going to happen. That's not the storm I'm talking about. But it ought to be awakening for you and I to set up and pay attention to what's fixing to be said. Listen to the next thing. And Jesus said to them, do you see? Can I ask you, do y'all see? It's so simple and yet so hard. Do you see? I look for God in everything. I don't look for demons. I don't care about them. I have authority over them. They are not my issue. My issue is Lewis and not listening to God and doing the will of God. Oh, come on. This thing is about seeing. Do you see? He's asked a question. It's a really important question that you and I need to understand, because he's fixing to unpack four major things here. He's going to talk about great deception. He's going to talk about political unrest. Are we there? Are we there in our deception? Are we there in our political unrest? He's going to talk about great natural disasters. Phone there. In the place you least expect it, that's what happens. Now I got a rabbit I got to chase, and this may be as far as I get today, but you need to listen to this rabbit. What if they hit the tower with four planes hit the tower with two and Pentagon with one, and one crashed because people stood up and said, no, weren't going to let that happen. Manned up. Thank God for those. But what's going to happen when that happened? What took place? They shut down everything in our country. Everything stopped for about a week. You couldn't, no trucks rolled. Do y'all know most stores have one day's groceries? Isn't that right, Jeff? At the most two? Because there has to be trucks every day pulling into those grocery stores or you don't have food. What happens if we have a Madrid fault and it drops the Mississippi River? All the bridges are cut off. All the electrical lines, all the gas lines, all the oil lines are broke. That can happen. What happens to our country if it's split in two? You think there's going to be some chaos? Do you think people are going to run to the grocery stores? Now, here's the problem. See, I think like this. It's my old police mind. The strong survive, the weak will be first. You don't have electricity? What about all the people that have insulin in refrigerators? They're all dead. I hope none of you are taking insulin, you know, but you want to get some that don't have to be refrigerated if you can get it, I don't know, but just that, I think like that. There's a deputy coroner, I'm thinking, oh my God, all these people are going to die. What about people that's on oxygen, that's plugged in, no electricity, they're all dead. My Lord, that could happen. They're talking about the Yellowstone, the ground rising up because of the heat and the pressure underneath for this super volcano. That could happen. I don't want you to walk out here scared. This is what I got to be careful. I don't want to be so heavy on you. You're thinking, oh, my God. No. Oh, my God. He's the man in the fire. We sang about him. He's the man in the fire. I don't care what's going on around me. I have a God that will walk with me. Even in a storm, he will be there. Now, don't y'all run out and buy a bunch of groceries. You're thinking, oh, this preacher says that this is going to happen. I just said, what if it happened? Do you see? Do you see all these buildings? What happened to them buildings? Every last one of them was tore down. Let's go back to the temple. He never returned to that temple, y'all. Woe to them when I depart. That's Hosea chapter 9. I think you have it for me there. Hosea chapter 9. Look at this statement. Hosea chapter 9 verse 12 says, though they bring up their children, yet will I bereave them to the last man. Yes, woe to them when I depart from them. What's he saying? He left the temple and he left it desolate. Oh, we are the temple of the living God. Do not let God depart from your temple. Love him. Obey him. Keep his commandments. Do what's right. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 8. It's the next one. I just thought a couple kind of give us a little shock and awe this morning. There's a storm coming. Be instructed. Listen, you're being instructed. O Jerusalem, I'm going to say, O church. I'm just going to, because we are like Jerusalem. We don't replace them. We're like them. O church. Lest my soul depart from you, lest I make you desolate, a land not inhabited. Now, I could go into a whole bunch of that, but just the point is, Jesus departed from that temple. We, as the temple of the living God, do not want him departing from us. Then we need to be steadfast in our call to do what's right. Now, let me move on. Think about it now. The glory departed from the temple. Because Jesus is the glory of the Father. At Jesus' death, y'all remember that the temple was tore from top to bottom, which in Levitical terms, in ceremonial terms, it became unclean. It was no longer set apart. When that veil ripped, it was over. The ceremonial law was over. The Levitical priesthood was over at the tearing of that veil. Because anybody could walk in there then. This is about seeing patterns like we've never seen them. I just tell you. And what's interesting is he went, in verse 3, I can get there. And now he sat on Mount of Olives, and his disciples came to him privately saying, hey, tell us when this is going to happen. What's going to be a sign? What was the problem with the Jews? They were always wanting a sign. He gave them a sign. They didn't want that. He said, you'll see the Son of Man. In the ground 3 days and three nights, as Jonah was in the belly of the well, and he shall rise up, and you'll see him go into glory. Now that's a sign. Did they accept it? Not only there. Listen to the statement. Now, as he sat, he's in the chair now, as he sat, rock, whatever, on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came and privately tell us when these things will be and when will be the sign of your coming. I just read it to you, y'all. You want to know what a sign is coming? Go back to Thessalonians and read it. That's the sign of the coming and the end of the age. And Jesus answered. What did he answer? He said, take heed that no man deceive you. First words out of his mouth. And he repeats it three times in this chapter. What did I say to you? Seducers are more dangerous to the church than persecutors. You just think on that for a while. Let me point something out that I found in this when I was studying it. When he sat down as a judge in a courtroom. Y'all do know judges sit at a bench. They don't stand when they give judgment. Right? Any of y'all ever been in a courtroom, you know that. When Jesus sat down, he told him there wouldn't be a rock left in that building. It'd all be, what did he do as judge? He judged it. And he said, this is what will happen. Boom. And within 40 years, the whole temple was destroyed. Everything was plowed up except the western wall. Why? So they'd have a remnant to remember what he said. And they go to that wailing wall and they cry for the coming of the Lord. And they have no clue what they're praying. Praise God. You see, he not only declared a verdict, he declared a judgment, and he ended it right there. Christ departed not until they drove him away. He didn't reject them, y'all. They rejected him. And that's when he left. And it was over. Please be careful that you don't reject Jesus when he's talking to you. Please listen when he says something to you. When I speak something and it grabs you, you write that down and go find that in the Word. Don't trust Lewis. Go find it in the Word. Because I'm telling you, he's coming. And there's going to be some terrible stuff that's going to happen. And we're not to look at the stuff. We're to look to Jesus. He's the one in the fire. He's the one that will be there when we need him. But we got to be able to talk to him and understand what he wants. You see, they expected to be told the things it would be. And this is not what they got. They got, what's that to you? That's what he said. What he said was, you mind your duty, you follow me, and you don't be seduced by what's fixing to happen. And this is going to happen. Great deception, political unrest, natural disasters, and religious persecution. Now let's just go there for a minute. In California, they said they can't sing about Jesus. That's persecution. Yeah. Now it may be soft persecution, but it'll get a lot worse, like soft porn and real porn. Soft porn, they still got clothes on, but it's very suggestive. Real porn ain't. This is what I'm talking about. This political unrest starts off kind of soft. Well, you can't sing about Jesus. You can't have the Ten Commandments. You can't pray in school. That's all soft persecution. The storm's coming. And we're not to be afraid of the storm. We're to be looking because he is telling us this stuff's going to happen and I'm coming. I told you already, he's coming. Our excitement ought to be in the fact that it could be this year. It could be next year. It could be any minute. But the other side of that is you can walk out of this car, building, get in a car and get out on the street and somebody run over you and you're in the presence of God. It happened in this place with one of our sisters. That means we need to be ready, not worried about when he's coming. We need to be ready to meet him right now. As I tell some of my French brothers, right now. R-A-T, right now. Okay? You need to see what's happening here. He says, take heed that no one deceive you. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ. That's verse 5. And will deceive many. Now, y'all, I got so many notes and so many things to tell you, but let's just stop and end this today with this thought. Since Jesus was born, I'm going to go over to my chart. No, I can do it with a pen. Shoot, I forgot I bought one for that purpose. Now, here's the thing. I'm going to be nervous when I'm shaking it. Since Jesus was born, A.D., to 2020, Gregorian time, that's where we are. Now, y'all, avail yourself to the chart after church. Take pictures, look at it. There it is. I want y'all to understand something. On that chart is the revelation of who God is in a way you've never seen him. Now, listen to this. That's Gregorian time. God operates in God time, not man's time. Oh, can I show it to you? It's a small rabbit. John, Revelations. John in Revelations, chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3. He's on earth looking up at heaven and watching what's going on. Chapter 4, he says, come up here. the doors open in heaven. He says, come up here. And he takes John to heaven. And now John is looking at it like God looks at it, down at the earth. And he's seeing it like God sees it. You and I have to see it like God sees it. That's just 2 days to him. Y'all, this thing is about understanding the first fruits. This thing is about understanding the principles of the living God. And so if we would learn the things we're supposed to know, it would cause us to want to obey like we've never wanted to obey. We would want to listen. We would want to know how to pray. We want to listen when God speaks. And listen, he's always speaking to you 99% of the time through the Word. But even audibly, he can say something to you. You need to be quick to hear it and then to respond to it with, yes, Lord. We sang a song in Cleansing Stream called, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Oh, come on. I want to get in a place when God speaks this, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. What do you want me to do? Yes, Lord. I'm going to do it. Praise the name of the living God. Go for it, sir. It was a great ministry. It taught me a lot. Here's my point. And I chased too many rabbits. From there to there, we've always, the church has always, for 2,000 years, the church has always enjoyed Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, Pentecost. For you that are worldly, Easter, okay? That's a worship of a Roman female god. And that's just all I got to say. You don't ever, hardly ever hear me say Easter. I don't say Easter. I say Passover. I refuse to give that demon any homage whatsoever. Now, I ain't fussing at y'all if y'all use Easter. That's okay. If you just know what you're supposed to know, you probably wouldn't want to say that. No more than you'd want to talk about pandemic. Pandemic. That's a demon. Pan is a Greek demon. It's a goat with horns. And there's a black girl singing on the TV, and she's dancing. BC, B, well, I don't know what her name is. Starts with a B. And she's wearing horns and hunching around on the stage in a very provocative outfit. What is she worshiping? A demon? Pan? And now we got pandemic? Y'all, just, somebody needs to back up here and look at some of this. And all I'm saying to you is, in 2,000 years, the church has always enjoyed those festivals until 20. We didn't get to do Passover together. We didn't get to do unleavened bread together. We didn't get to do first fruits together. We didn't get to do Pentecost together. That's in Daniel chapter 7. It may be in my notes, but I'll just read it to them. Don't fret over. I'm going to end with this. Ooh. Better hurry, Daniel 7. Listen to this statement. Y'all ain't going to like this. Daniel 21. I'm watching, and the same horn was making war against the saints. Who do you all think the saints are? Oh, you be one. He's making war against the saints and prevailing against them. Ooh, why would he do that? This is deep, y'all. Deep calling unto deep. Where you at over there? Deep calling unto deep. Until the Ancient of Days came and a judgment was made in favor of the saints. Praise the living God. He said, enough is enough. You'd think that was the best of it, but it's going to get worse. It ain't going to get better. Listen to this. In favor of the saints, and the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. What are you and I supposed to be doing? We're supposed to be possessing the kingdom. Are we? I sure like to think we were. The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom on earth, and blah, blah, blah. And I'm not going to go through the kings and the horns, and they're all representative stuff, and today ain't the time to tell you. But let's go up here to verse 25. Here's the key. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High. He shall persecute the saints. Dude, he's still persecuting us. And shall intend to change, listen, the times and the seasons. Do y'all think we just had a season change? We never got to do Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, our Pentecost. He is changing the times and the seasons right in front of us. You know, y'all, I ain't got time to tell you today about the patterns, but I will rock your world. I'm going to take you somewhere else. And y'all got to come back for this. I want you to look right here. Warrant thou. This is a Psalms 83 war. It's in my notes. I just hadn't got to there. This is a Psalms 83 war. Psalms 83. Can I have five more minutes? Okay. Five more minutes. Y'all give it up. I'll take it. Psalms 83. Do not keep silent, O God. Do not hold your peace. Do not be still, O God. Y'all think that ought to be the way we ought to be praying? Absolutely. For your enemies, behold, your enemies make a tumult. And those who hate you have lifted up their head in this country. They hate God. And unfortunately, it seems like there's more people today that hate God than used to. I'm going to drop down. It's a confederacy. Verse 5 says, and they have consulted together in one consent, and they have formed a confederacy against you. The tents of Edom, y'all see them up there? And Ishmaelites, Moab, Gagarites. That probably needs a drink of water. That tasted nasty. Gerbel, Ammon, Amalek, Philistia, Tyre, Assyria. And they have helped the children of Lot. Y'all see that? There it is. Well, let's take a moment. Y'all give me five. Let me tell you. Edom, that's found in the destruction of it, is in Isaiah 21:11. North Lebanese. Y'all have heard of the North Lebanese, haven't you? Ishmaelites are Saudi Arabians. Moab is the Palestinian refugees and central Jordanians. I know y'all heard of them. Gerbel is the north. Oh, wait a minute. Gergat, that nasty one. That's Egyptians. Gerbel is North Lebanese. Ammon is the Palestinian refugees and the northern Jordanians. Amalek is the south Arab south of Israel. Philistia is the Philistines. That's PLO, Hamas, and the Gaza Strip. But have they been giving Israel a fit? And they will kill you in a minute. They hate us. Tyre is the Hezbollah and southern Lebanese. Assyria is Syria. And northern Iraq. Now, y'all got to note something about northern Iraq. Northern Iraq and Syria are Arabs. But Iran is not Arabs. They're Persians. They hate the Arabs. They hate one another. That's why they killed one another all the time. All the time fighting. Iran and Iraq. All the time fighting. There it is. Then you got the children of Lot, which is Moab and Ammon, which were the sons of Lot through his daughters. Incest. There are 11 of these. 11's the number of judgment. That's the number of judgment. There's 11 of them. You come out of Egypt. There were 10 plagues in Egypt. But he judged them with 11. Because when they got to the Red Sea, when they parted, the Egyptians went down in the sea and he closed it on them. That was number 11. 11. So this thing is about understanding these are the plagues of Egypt. These people have been a plague to the children of God. And you are a child of God. There is a storm coming. Now, I got one more thing. I told you about the Iran's are Shiites, Arabs are Sunnis. That's your two, that's Republicans and Democrats. Democrats and Republicans. I'm that's the kind of understanding of the split, okay? I'm not trying to be careful here because I've stepped over the line. I don't want to do that again. Isaiah 17:1 says, listen, behold, Damascus will cease from being a city and will become a ruinous heap. Y'all do know that Damascus is the oldest inhabited city in the world. From its beginning to now. So one writer says 2.5 million people in Damascus. But it's fixing to become a ruinous heap. You know there's a storm coming. Okay. What on earth have we ever seen that gives us a picture of a ruinous heap? Hiroshima? Nagasaki? But I got one better. Chernobyl. Chernobyl. It is a ruinous heap today. You can't live in it. Just a thought. There is a storm coming. About understanding this, then, we need to understand that God is speaking to His people, and it's our responsibility to be saying, "Yes, Lord, here am I. Use me." Because you see, the deception that's coming is a very great deception. When you can't even have a Passover together, you can't meet. They won't allow you to meet because of this sickness. Can I tell you something good came out of it? No abortions. God stopped the abortions. Not all of them, but He shut them down. So He took what was evil and He turned it around for good. Is that not the God I serve? That He's capable. Y'all listen, I don't want you to leave here heavy. I want you to leave here looking up, because there's a God that's coming and He's calling out to you and to me to do the work of the kingdom according to His word, not what I want to do. Because I can guarantee you, if He says, "Okay, Lewis, do what you want to do," I'm going to go house sit in the chair. It ain't the way it works. He's going to say, "I got something for you to do." "Yes, Lord." And usually, I've never met a time that I could do it without Him. It always requires me saying, "Oh, God, I can't do this. I know You can't, so take me with You and I'll do it for You." Okay. He's with me in the fire. Yellow. We sang it. I wanted to jump, run, and dance. And when you busted out with that cleansing stream song there, I did that dance, but 10 years ago, I'd have done an even bigger dance. 10 years makes a difference, y'all. 70, it just does something to a fella. I thought 50 was bad, and I can guarantee you 70 is worse. But the other side of stopping that, I'm not really interested in doing, so I'll just keep plugging. I want you to stand with me. Now, I want y'all to listen to me while y'all stand. Listen. There's a storm coming. I'm going to pick up right here with my notes, and I'm going to talk to you about this. Because see, in verse 1, it says they walked with God. My question is, are we walking with God? In verse 2, it says, attention back to God. They went to Him to get the answer. Are we going back to God? That's my question. Are we? And then the first 3, he says, they came to Him privately. Are y'all finding your still quiet spot and talking with God? Are we? Verse 4 of Matthew says, many were deceived. Are we? Have we gotten lazy and slowful and fat and we don't want to pray? We really don't want to pray for an hour. And then you're talking fasting, doing without food? It's not popular. We need to. Today, 5 o'clock. There'll be light music. Lights will be down. This is not a social time. You come in here, you pray. Pray for an hour. Your challenge. Pray for an hour. Are you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You for what You did today. I thank You that You met with Your people. I thank You that every word that was spoken will come to pass according to Your will and Your glory, that we can stand together and praise You. I thank You for that, Father. I ask You now, as we go from this building, the words that have been spoken, if they were mine, let them fall to the ground. But if they're Your words, the words that went out, let them bear the fruit they're supposed to bear, that we will truly possess Your kingdom for Your glory. For we would all say, "Yes, Lord, here am I." I ask You, Father, move in a miraculous way. Move over Sandy at home and over Joey in the hospital. Move in such a way that we will stand in awe of that the next time we come together. Lord, I thank you for your protection over us against the pandemics of this world. They have no place in us. We will stand true to your word and our faith and see your kingdom manifested as we possess it for your glory. Bless everyone going out, Father. Let your word rise up in them. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Now would you raise a hand and receive a blessing, a priestly blessing? May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord's face be upon you. May his countenance overtake you. May the will of the Father and his call to you be, yes, Lord, here am I. Be blessed going in. Be blessed coming out. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all are welcome to look at the chart. If y'all are interested, there it be.